So I'm going to talk about Psychosynth, which is a project that I started last summer. It's been part of a Spanish contest of free software for university students, and it's been the winner project. I'm going to talk first about the concept, what are we trying to achieve, then development and what features does the program has, and last we will talk about future development as the program is still under heavy development. There are many things to be done. So first of all, we'll talk about what is Psychosynth. We can describe Psychosynth as an audio synthesizer, which means it is an electronic device to make sound. A sound especially designed to make sounds for music. But there are some adjectives we can add to it, and it's that it's a modular audio synthesizer, that it's an interactive audio synthesizer, and that it's collaborative. And there are some more things that will be seen on the implementation part. So, what is it, a modular audio synthesizer? We can define it more formally, as a system where audio generation is described by a directed graph where each node represents a functional transformation of its input signals and emits some output. This means that you have modules that get sound signals, or maybe no sound signals, or you have you need some source sounds to transform and modify in other nodes and get it to an output node that emits the sound, which would be our amplifier or speakers. So this was invented in 1963 by Robert Moog. Those kind of synthesizers were modular, such as the one on the screen, and you have a big panel where you have to connect with wires the different modules. And in the 90s, computer got faster. You are able to do all this process in real time, and this gives us much more freedom, as we in a computer we can model more easily other kind of signals. This concept has a clear pro, and it's that creative freedom is virtually unlimited, in the sense that as you have new models, you have many new ways of interconnecting them, and your freedom to design a new song grows exponentially. But on the other hand, it has very little interaction. Before a performance, you have to interconnect the wires, you have to set the parameters, and it's in some way hard to change the sounds in the performance. So there comes interactive modular audio synthesizers, and in this case we have two solutions proposed in software modular synthesizers. Incorporating this one, which is the Rectable project developed in the University Pompeu Fabra of Barcelona, where they have a surface, and they implement something called dynamic patching. A patch is the graph that we described before, and in this case they describe the synthesizer as a flat surface, as a plane, where you drop the nodes and they interconnect automatically based on their relative position. This one connect automatically if they have any compatible input or output free. And also they have multi-tactile interfaces, such as the one on the screen. So this allows a better control over more parameters, especially in software synthesizers, which usually were controlled with your mouse and keyboard, which are on a dimensional interfaces. And also the sanitizer is collaborative. Why? Because still one person is able to control the parameters and to create rich enough music. Since music started, music has been played by several people. And this is necessary to bring this concept to electronic music in live performances, as it is very weird to conceive music if it isn't played by several people. So the solution to achieve this may be a multi-tactile interface big enough to be used by several people, as they do in the Red Table project, which is quite an expensive approach, and also network connection, which, if developed enough, may allow collaborative performances over distant places, not only in the same place, and also have some other collateral advantages, such as distributing different parts of the system, such as the sound generation and the video processing or any other. So, as I said, most of these ideas were already implemented on the Vertable project, and this has become very popular on the internet because of the YouTube videos, and everybody says, "This is so cool, I want one." And most people try to find somewhere to buy it, and they are going to buy it in the future as privative software and hardware, and it will be very expensive, but you can buy it one. So, we decided to do it yourself, and as we wanted to have one, we decided to make ours. But if we wanted just to make a simple copy, we would have some problems. First of all, the table, the projector, and the camera are very expensive for a student like me. Also, that is a research project which is written in Puredata, which is a language, a graphical language, which is interesting to experiment with audio applications, but to make a product where you want to a perspective to the future, I thought that it was not the best language to write this on, because of efficiency and extensibility, primarily extensibility concerns. And also, the ideas that the Rectable project has proposed are innovative, but the only person who has tried in live performances the Rectable is the artist Björk, and well, we still don't know if the musician community will find it really useful for the performances. So it will be much better if our system could be extensible, and in the future it will allow to incorporate new ideas that are better than the Rectable ones. So finally, we decided to write a C++ framework for the development of synthesizer that are, as we said, interactive, collaborative, and modular. Much of the work had to be done from zero. We have new libraries for the graphical part and also for some synthesis process, but we don't use, for example, GORM and other frameworks that already exist for modular things, as they don't fit well in our idea of interactive and collaborative things. And also, we want to write a 3D simulator of a Rectable Alive device as an example of what can be done using this framework, and also a command line version that can communicate with a three-dimensional simulator and any other, actually virtually any other synthesizer built over a framework. You will use a model view controller pattern, but actually the graph, the synthesis graph is inside the model, and it can be decoupled from the model view controller system and used isolated. It's multi-layer, and dynamic patching are in the model too, which, well, it has some advantages when related to the network implementation, but they are interchange, you can change it dynamically, so in case, as we said, there are some better ideas to do the patching of the objects, well, you can implement a new algorithm. And the network system lives on the visual controller layer, which is, for our purposes, I think, the best idea. Consequences of this are that it's rather easy to write new interfaces that implement maybe other ideas different than the Reptable ones. And also, all views and controllers can communicate homogeneously. This means that you may have some different or completely different interfaces to control the modular system, but the modular system behind is the same, and the network system is not coupled to your way of controlling it. So this is the important advantages. I don't have time to explain very deeply this bridge-side class pair diagram of the framework parts of the synth. So now let's talk about the synthesis objects that are included in the program. As we said, we have nodes that interconnect to process the signals, but we didn't say which. Well, we have on one hand generators. We obviously need this. They have generate a source sound that you can use for later processing, and we have, for example, basic waves, a sinus wave, a square wave, a triangle, some other ones. Also, we have noise, for example, white noise, which has a flat spectrum, or pink noise that has a linear spectrum, linear degradation spectrum, which is more wave. And we also have some samples, which are very important generator. They are just audio files, and they are very important, especially for DJs or to inject directly complex sounds that you have recorded outside. And in these samples, you can change the pitch. This means that you can play it faster, like if you have a vinyl disc, play more revolutions per minute than the standard, or you can do backwards playback, play in a satanic way. And you can do time stretching, which means that you can pitch the pitch without altering the tempo of the song. You can make me speak with a more brave voice without making me speak slower, and the opposite situation, which is making a song sound faster without changing its tone. We also have filters which process and transform an audio signal, and we have in the current implementation two kinds, which are the one on the spectrum manipulation filters, which change the spectrum of the signal. You have low pass filters that make the sound more grave, high pass change it to a higher pitch, band pass, notch pass, they all change the spectrum and limit the band to a band of the spectrum. And you also have special effects such as echo, delay, and flanger are very used by DJs. And on the other hand, we have sequencers. These are not typical of audio synthesizers or modular synths, but this is more than a modular synth. So this allows you to generate rhythms, to tell songs when and how they have to play. We have now some basic ones. I want to prove it later. We'll talk in the future section about synchronization and other issues we have to cope with. We have controllers that are signals like audio signals, but while audio signals are multi-channel, you have stereo signals or polyphonic signals, controls are fully unidimensional, and they can be used in the same way as generators, filters and sequencers, but to control parameters of other objects. This is a screenshot of the three-dimensional interface that we wrote, and as we can see, we have green squares that are generators. This is a sine wave generator, and this is a frame, and they are automatically connected with a filter, for example, and this point in the thermometer is the sink, and it is the audio output which goes through your speakers. And in the connections, this is a quite important feature. You have a visual feedback of the signal that is going through that connection. So when you put a filter, you can automatically see how this has affected to the signal visually.
Do you actually make use of the three-dimensional nature of the space? It looks like you've got a plane and you're just moving the things about.
Well,
it
could
be just a 2D display.
Actually, it could have been done in 2D. You have all objects are in a flat surface, but three-dimensional interface on the one hand allows you to make it function. If you are in a live performance, you can be showing this on a screen. And also, there are some interesting things such as zooming, because when you move your mouse, you are actually moving some pixels, and these pixels may refer to adapting some edge of the frequency of the sound. And if you zoom in, these pixels mean a lower range. You know? So you can make softer. This is a way to dynamically changing the resolution of your input. Well, we will talk more about the interface later, and I'll show the program, Brian. And finally, some applications of this software. Maybe the first application, Clearly, which has motivated all the development, is music creation, with complete musical works using it, and in opposite to other music software, we don't want to build our work and then we go to a live performance, click play and sit down. We want it to be we want us to be able to do all the work in front of our audience. And it's also interesting just for remixing, to be used by DJs on clubs and such, because most of the filters that DJ software have, we have it, and actually maybe in a way that allows them more freedom. Also, it's very interesting for development, people who want to experiment writing new interfaces and controllers for modular synthesis system can use our library and write the software using it. And maybe some others could be sound didactics, such as teaching the physical nature of sound, because it's interesting maybe for the student to put a pure sound, such as sine wave, and then maybe change the pitch, change or put filters and directly see the waves, and such. Some points, it's 30,000 lines of C++ code. During the contest, several 7,000 lines were changed for now. And GPL3 license for the library too. Some more points, such as it has also Jack support. Jack is quite important for audio professionals because it allows interconnecting many different audio software and the new Linux. It includes 40 loops made by Shaker, which is a DJ who is quite interested in the project, and they are Creative Commons share alike. Well, it won the second free software contest. One interesting thing is that many people of the music making community use Macs and they don't care about free software and they find it boring because there are many good software for to make audio under GNU Linux, in my opinion, but they have a big geek conception because they all work around Jack and you have to manually interconnect them. They have quite a Unix philosophy, you know, where you interconnect all program with pipes. Here you interconnect everything with Jack, and they usually use big software packages that are commercial, that have super and integrate all the functionalities in one software. And this kind of software, seems in that philosophy of easy to use, you can open it and start playing with it. And many people who, as I said, wanted to buy the web table, now want to install GNU Linux and try PsychoSync. And also the web table staff got interested in PsychoSync because now they're trying to rewrite everything in C++ because they discovered that Pure Data was not the right choice. So I'm happy with my decision. And finally, let's talk about some things that may be implemented in the future. Shaker, the DJ that I said that was quite interested in the project, I talked with him quite a lot and he highlighted 2 points. The first one is synchronization mechanism, because now when you play a note, it starts playing directly. You don't have any way to sync some events between distinct notes. And for example, of a controller wave, it is very interesting to make its speech a multiple of a value that sits in another part of the synth. And well, I'm studying how to implement synchronization. I have some ideas, and I hope that in August I will put my hand on it. Also, pseudo channels mean the ability to make chunks of samples that play one after another, so you don't have to play it, to put it on the table just in the moment that where you want to it to be played. And also, some of my priorities are, on the one hand, plugins, because a modular system makes no sense without plugins, because each audio professional has its own software that does its own process, developed by professionals at signal manipulation. And there are standards, such as the ones exposed at LP2, LastFab, Desi, that allow you to load a plugin and use it in your processing engine. But the most used one is DST, which is a proprietary one. I think that it has patents and it's Windows only. But there is some kind of blocker made under Wine with some free software projects, so I have to investigate how to use it, because most people ask for VST. Most people obviously are outside the free software or free music making community, which love LV2 and LASP. Also, RecDivision is the only part that is free software in the RecTable project, and it's a software that has pattern recognition with web cameras, and it allows you to put a web camera under a table and with some special shapes called fiducials, it can recognize them and its rotation and use it to create a multi-tactile interface. With the design of our framework, I think that it would be quite easy to integrate that software with PsychoSync and build multi-tactile interfaces for it, and this is something that I want to do in the future too. And also more effects and generators, and especially audio and MIDI input, so you can process other instruments or your own voice inside the system. And the claim of the message is proprietary platforms support, such as macOS, which is the most used by music people on Windows, but I have no interest in doing all the work because there are some dependencies that I think that are like a little messy to compile on the Windows and such. So till now this is not my priority, such as there is a long to-do list. But if anyone has any interest, he can do it. Some links, and well, let's show the program. One second. So this is the three-dimensional interface with easy mouse gestures. You can move around, and here you have, well, you can create network sessions, configure it, record the sound that you are playing, and obviously place objects. So to generate a sound, you just pick up an object and place it on the table, and it automatically interconnects. How does this work?
The speaker should work with the power, I think.
It's working, but it's very... one second. This is about maximum, so... where's the mic to... Well, I try to use my own laptop's speakers, even though they don't sound very well. For example, SoundWave is not playing because laptop speakers don't have great sounds. Now they play. This is a pure tone. It's not pure because the speakers are not very good. And we can add control signals, for example, the same way. It connects automatically and it starts manipulating its pitch. If we move it next to the center, it changes the amplitude of the global sync. We can add some sequencing. I was changing some things last week, and I think that I broke something. Well, now they're working. And now you can add, for example, an echo. And maybe one of the most interesting parts are the samplers, because you can take samples and they... Oh.
When we were writing the program, it was with this kind of sound all the day.
Yes. This explains why I'm a bit mad. So, well, you can mute a connection just by clicking on it, and you can also control this kind of things. For example, if we add a triangle wave to this, now the speed or the pitch is being manipulated by it. And also you can annotate control signals as much as you want. So you can add a move sound to this one. Well, it's hard to... Wait. You can create the pitch of this and then the pitch of this with this other one, which allows you to create more complex signals. By rotating the object, you change its pitch. And time stretching is not yet mapped to any kind of visual handler, so you have to take the manual manipulator. So now it's playing with a higher pitch but with the same tempo. Well, now it's saturated. Or you can play it faster, but without changing speech, as you will do if you just rotate it. Well, this is most of it. If you have any questions or want to play. Yeah?
So, when you're using the program interactively and you create kind of scene of musical objects.
Yeah.
How can you kind of export that as a kind of scene graph and then manipulate it from the text editor and then load it back in?
You mean storing it and to be able to load it later? It's not implemented yet.
Okay.
So
it's purely performance at the moment?
Yeah, but that's an interesting feature that will be done because obviously when you are even if you want to do everything in the performance, you will want to, while you're preparing it, to
yeah.
be able to, oh, I like this song, I start it and then
yeah.
try to get it again and
yeah.
things like that.
Because I remember like in the old, like, you know, like Quake and that, in the demos, instead of, you know, recording like a video of what was being rendered, we just recorded all the objects, all their states, like all their interactions.
Mm-hmm.
So when you played back the demo, I thought it might be interesting to kind of have, like, instead of having the recording to an audio file, just record all the state changes.
Yeah.
So.
That will also be developed in the future, actually. I showed only the most important or more high priority features that I'm going to implement, but on the website I published a roadmap draft with many more features like that. Also, for example, it will be interesting when we have plugin support to have a way to map visual controls to the plugin, because you have the plugin tells you I have these parameters, but maybe a plugin have 15 parameters and you want only to show two or three on the screen and to manipulate them, and you will have a graphical interface to say I want to map this parameter with this, and also to create sessions. For example, we have here the object selector and every object has its default parameters, but it would be interesting that you could configure which objects can you see in the selector to map shortcuts to them,
like
change the default parameters to prepare your performance.
Like a DJ.
Yeah.
So when you're using this tool collaboratively, what does the other person see on their laptop? If you're moving one of your objects, does it move on their screen as well?
Yeah.
And are you transmitting the sound file between each other, or do you have to have a local copy on your machine? It's the same as one over there.
You need a local copy of the files in your machine, and right. We only transmit the events. So it uses a protocol which is called OpenSound Control, which is not really about a protocol, it is some kind of meta protocol, which usually leads over UDP, which allows lower latencies, which are important in all the applications. And well, it's fun to play.
Have you tried distributed with musicians in different places, not like even in the same room? Have you tried?
I have tried with Wi-Fi, but on the same LAN. Over the internet, I think that the current prototype implementation will not perform very well over the internet. I haven't really tried it yet, but I have the feeling that it won't work very well. But it works quite well on local networks.